the issue of reforms, both yourself and President Ruto have been aligned. That being the case, what reforms do you really think should pave the way for giving Africa the resources that it needs to finance its own transformation and inclusive growth, either even in the face of devastating climate change? What are the most critical reforms that you see and anticipate are needed?
Thank you. Let me quickly, first of all, and more importantly, thank our hosts, President Ruto, His Excellency, and also the President of the Africa Development Bank Group for inviting us here. Now, quickly to the point, we are talking about the architecture of international financial architecture. Therefore, in mind, we have the architects. So what did the architect have in mind when they provided us with the architecture we have to deal with? They must have had their own interests. They must have framed things the way they wanted to benefit themselves, or maybe we can assume that they wanted to benefit the whole world. Now, we are here discussing the situation as it is, where we find there are enormous resources in this world, but inequitably distributed. So Africa has to look at itself and look at the whole world as it's set up. And we know in this world, people, countries, work for interests, their own interests. Africa's interests and the countries of our continent interests must be taken care of, beginning with ourselves. So, and we talk about speaking with one voice many times. It has to be one voice. It has also to be loud and clear and effective. For that to happen, we think about working together. We think about representation. And representation is not also just numbers. It's being able to speak out loudly and representing ourselves rather than having other people represent us. So it starts from what has been talked about that is very important, whether it was in the speech of His Excellency President Ruto and His Excellency Musa Faki. Therefore, the reforms we are talking about is how do we disrupt, if you will, the current architecture as we have it, so that it includes significantly and visibly the interests of our continent. Our continent, whether it is the human resources or natural resources or any resources are thinking about. How can anyone interested in the well-being of the people of this world sideline our continent? In actual fact, if you look at the facts as they are, in a few decades, the only place in this world that will be having a growing middle class is Africa, the only one. So it is even in the interest of the rest of the world that has marginalized Africa to contribute to the well-being of our continent, because the growth of Africa based on this middle class feeds into the growth of the rest of the world. So they should even be accepting some of these proposals in self-interest, because Africa grows, the whole world grows. But Africa cannot wait to be handed this opportunity by anybody else. We therefore must be on the front line, really fighting for this right, and therefore for ourselves, but also which contributes to the well-being of the rest of the world.
President Kagame, I want to be a little bit provocative here. I've been coming to Kenya for probably 30 years, and there are places that I used to know that I no longer recognize. Why? Because the city's architects have changed the landscape. Now, most of the Bretton Woods institutions were created 60 to 80 years ago at a different time from the one that we live in. So, if we're going to talk about reform, it's not just the access to resources. It's looking at those institutions that were created back then and asking the question, are they still relevant to the needs of today? What is your thought about redesigning a lot of these institutions to make them fit for purpose?
Well, absolutely. It's a no-brainer that what worked 50 years ago or designed 50 years ago, things have changed, and therefore a rethink of a new design that fits the purpose must be into play. There's no question about it. But here what we are talking about is not simply an argument of whether, you know, this is fit for purpose or this. I think everybody understands that point. But there are philosophies, if you will, or interests or that operate behind that. For us in Africa, we are hard-pressed to see that there is a change of this and in the design of these institutions. But maybe the way the institutions are set up, benefiting some parts of the world, those in those parts of the world are not interested in having the change happen, because it gives them control, it gives them say over other people's resources even. So it's not that people don't understand. Especially for Africa, we understand it better because of how we are affected. But the other parts of the world that have the power and control, it's also not because they don't understand, but it is because that it serves them very well, benefits them, that they are not interested or they are slow in allowing change to happen. So it's not a very complicated thing to understand. Everybody understands that. What is complicated is to reach this understanding and compromise that we don't lose anything by having everybody benefit as we should benefit all of us. That's where the issue lies. And therefore, the reforms are based on this thinking. We are only looking for the pathways to having the reforms implemented that provide us with less costs than having to fight so much over what is obvious that actually benefits all of us, as I said.
Thank you very much, President Kagame. I'm going to come next to President Al Menfi. Let me bring it closer home. Obviously, your country has had quite a number of challenges economically in recent times. What areas do you think that the African Development Bank can support Libya in the best to help you reach that last mile of reaching economic transformation in your country.
شكرا جزيلا. انا اعطي فرصه حتى للترجمه اذا كان في مشكله. I will talk in Arabic.
And President El Melfi, if you could just move your microphone a little bit closer to you.
في البداية أحب أن أشكر فخامة الرئيس روتورو على الضيافة وحسن الاستقبال والشعب الكيني، وأيضا على مجهوده الكبير الذي يقوم به في هذا التحول الذي أعتبره هو نقلة مهمة جدا في التحول المالي وكيفية معالجة المؤسسات المالية في أفريقيا. والحقيقة أيضا أريد أن أؤكد على نقطة أخرى، وهو أن أحيانا في بعض الدول الأفريقية الحاجة تكون للعناصر الفنية وللخبرات وليس المالية، وهذا ما يسمى بالتوأمة وما يسمى بالتكامل المالي داخل أفريقيا، والذي نرجو أن يكون هو الطموح الذي نريد أن نصل عليه. كل المؤسسات المالية أسست في فترة كانت فيها الدول الأفريقية قابعة تحت الاستعمار، وبالتالي أسست وفق آليات معينة لا تخدم أفريقيا، لكن أفريقيا اليوم هي أفريقيا أكثر تطوراً، أفريقيا فيها العديد من الثروات من الموارد، وبالتالي قدرة أفريقيا اليوم على البناء والتنمية تختلف عن أي وقت ماضي. والحقيقة نحن نريد أن نؤكد على أن الدور الذي قامت به ليبيا